Hey, if you enjoy my videos and would like to support me making more of them, please head over to my Patreon page, which is linked in the description of this video. Enjoy! What makes this album so great?
Well, Cowboy Sam's a major player in the Cowboy scene. He goes to the reservation, drinks some Jasmine, and he's gonna start a war. He's gonna start a war, and he hops in his pickup, puts a pen to the floor, and says, I got mine, but I want more.
Something's going on. There's some kind of magic that the band is... some kind of voodoo that band is working on the kids.
The reservation drinks and gets me. Goes to the desert, fires a rifle in the sky, says, God, if I have to die, you will have to die.
So the year was 1997. Modest Mouse, Seattle's indie darling at the time, was at their peak productivity, touring the US constantly, recording two full-length albums, two EPs, and three singles in just over a year. And on these US tours, their audiences were growing noticeably larger.
They became a very popular band. Quickly.
We were getting asked to play shows and not trying to get put on shows.
They were about to take a fresh batch of songs to Moon Studio in Olympia, Washington to record another album. Now, before we dive into the production of that album, I wanted to mention something I forgot to include in my last video, something fundamental to the early formation of Modest Mouse's style, and that's young Isaac Brock's love of early hip-hop. Whether it was Run-DMC, Korn, Limp Bizkit, it's fair to say that Isaac definitely had an early fascination with this style of white boy alternarap hip-hop. You hear this influence replete throughout their work, whether it's the inclusion of record scratching at the front of the mix, like in Heart Cook's Brain. Or more obviously, in Isaac's rap-tinged delivery.
But they go driving the wrong hand lane, bad breath, talking about fresh rain, what hand is gonna shake the same? Are you gonna be your own goddamn best friend? Well, we taught the fruit how to eat it.
So what's this new album gonna sound like as opposed to the older Modest Mouse stuff? I listened to a lot of Bob Dylan and without meaning to, biting his style pretty good.
The Lonesome Crowded West, in a way, isn't unique at all as a Modest Mouse album, and in many ways is a natural follow-up to their previous LP, This Is a Long Drive for Someone with Nothing to Think About. Thematically, Isaac continued writing lyrics about the suburbanization of America, convenience store parking lots, and dark, lonely road trips. For me, what makes this album so great is almost a matter of timing and circumstance. It occurred right at the perfect moment for this band where they as musicians had the perfect alchemy of both experience and naivety, unabashed experimentation combined with a growing understanding of how to effectively relate to their audiences.
I could listen to the lyrics and like hear him saying things about things that were going on in our lives that he would not say to me just in a conversation.
You know, I just don't think there's a lot of lyricists out there that do that.
I still love her. Love her more when she used me sober. That was kinder.
So like I mentioned, the recording of this album took place in Olympia, Washington, with legendary tastemaker Calvin Johnson and Scott Swayze behind the mixing board.
No,
17 consecutive days, mostly sleepless and long days, and the band sleeping on couches, various houses around town, and we would just record until we got so tired or until things just weren't making sense anymore, and then we just shut the place down and come in the next day and get at it again.
Eventually, producer Phil Eck, who in real life is actually my cousin, was brought in to re-record Teeth Like God's Shoeshine, Cowboy Dan, and Doing the Cockroach.
Doing the Cockroach!
wanted to know if you'd be interested in redoing a couple of these songs. He just didn't like the way it turned out. He did tell me they were pretty out of tune, but I never heard him. I never heard the original recordings. He didn't really want it to sound too out of place. He just wanted it to be true to the band and to sound a little bit more powerful.
Phil, some years later, told me that he was given specific instructions to not do too good a job recording it, you know, to make it better, but not, but to kind of shitty it up a bit.
You know, make it better, but not that much better.
So let's hear them side by side. Here's Phil's version, the one most of us know.
Well, Cowboy Dan's a major player in the Cowboy scene.
And here's the original.
Well, Cowboy Dan's a major player in the Cowboy scene.
Now, to be fair, this discrepancy isn't across the board. Like, in Calvin's recording, the middle section of the song is actually developed a lot more, featuring a production style reminiscent of what would be used on their upcoming album, The Moon in Antarctica.
You know, we need oxygen to breathe. Oxygen to breathe.
Every time I'm asked to use a song of ours for a skate thing, it's always the same song for like the last 20 years.
Really?
Yeah, it's shit luck, like almost without fail.
What more is there to say about this album? It's just great.
And I shout that you're all fake, and you should have seen the look on your face.
Like Pet Sounds or Sgt. Pepper, it's one of those albums that really benefits from an entire playthrough. It's like a very satisfying auditory journey from start to finish. I could break it down further, but Pitchfork already made a documentary all about this album, some of which I pulled clips from, where they break the album completely down song by song. I highly suggest checking that out. For our purposes, it's important to know that for many fans of Modest Mouse, this is their crowning jewel. While they continue to push their style outward, develop as musicians and songwriters, and achieve much more notoriety, the Lonesome Crowded West still has a legacy all its own in the hipster community, a cult fan base, which has developed over the decades since its release. At the time of its release, though, in 1997, it didn't, like, change the face of indie rock by any stretch. It was kind of just received as the next Modest Mouse album. But it was noticed by industry executives and A&R reps for big labels, who basically launched a low-key bidding war over who would sign the band. The two main contenders were DreamWorks and Epic. In the end, they went with Epic Records. At this time, in the landscape of rock, selling out was a big deal. It was something that every band wanted to achieve, but the moment you did, you were crossing this threshold where you give up all your cred, your musical integrity, in the interest of making pop music for pop radio. It's a criticism that just isn't there anymore. Fans tend to be happy for their favorite artists now when they achieve success. But at the time, Modest Mouse really had to defend the decision to sign to Epic Records to almost everyone. Almost their entire fan base felt entitled to sort of keep them to themselves. Here's what Isaac had to say in response to this supposed betrayal.
The f*** is that guy doing up there for?
Hipsters all have trust funds. These are people who can afford to have all these principles and ethics when it comes to doing music. From the time I came out the f***ing gate, I had to figure out how to help my family. And you're gonna f***ing tell me about punk rock principles and shit? Now more pragmatically, he also later stated, why wouldn't we want to do the best record we felt we could? Now, a lot of time passed before the band would re-enter the studio with a new batch of songs in July of 1999. Epic Records let them pick their own producer, and they went with Brian Deck from the band Red Red Meat, whom Isaac had met on the road on a previous tour. In contrast to Calvin Johnson or Phil Eck, Brian had a much more hands-on approach, offering bold ideas to the band, encouraging them to push themselves and challenge themselves, and providing a unique arsenal of unusual instruments the boys had never used before.
Emotions. Things that you say, it all will fall right into place.
Now, early Modest Mouse material is about space and space travel. It seems after his fixation on religious and country western motifs in Lonesome Crowded West, Isaac was ready to return to the subject matter of space. The overall mood of this album is also really distinct. It's much more somber and self-controlled. It's also full of bizarre and surrealist imagery. In this life like this, you're a rock to me. And definitely more sophisticated musically. And there was an interesting reason for that. Isaac Brock had gotten his ass beat. Quote, "They f***ed me up pretty good, but having my jaw broken was great in respect to its effect on the album, because I had to take a different approach to recording. Usually when we record, we lay down the basic tracks, and I feel guilty if I don't hurry up and get the vocals done. But this time I couldn't sing, so I just hung out, wrote a lot more instrumentals, and had a chance to really listen and work on it before laying down the vocals."
Projecting our lives down to this planet Earth. And the stars are projectors, yeah. Projecting our minds down to this planet Earth.
There's also a track on the album called Tiny Cities Made of Ashes, which is the next and perhaps boldest installment of Modest Mouse's tradition of including one or two horror-tinged dancehall thumpers on every album. The album would also feature the return of Phil Eck, tangents into Run DMC style hip hop, and homages to the Pixies. When it was completed, Isaac actually hated the album. He thought it was too clean and too overproduced. He had nervous breakdowns about it. Feeling stifled and micromanaged by major label expectations and deadlines, he started a side project, Ugly Casanova, and even went on tour with them. In interviews, he would describe this experience as a refreshing and reorienting return to lo-fi hands-on production, where Isaac himself got to make a majority of the production decisions again. The results are actually pretty great, and Ugly Casanova garnered a respectable following. Antarctica was being received with acclaim. People loved it. Granted, for many, this was their first time hearing the band, but it prompted droves of mainstream listeners to dive into their back catalog, where they would discover tons of great material. And so the Modest Mouse machine just kept churning. More touring, Lollapalooza, an EP of unused material from the Moon sessions, and more strange onstage antics, including an incident in August of 2002, where, after asking members of the audience multiple times if they had a knife, Isaac actually cut himself on stage. In 2003, in the middle of the song Interstate 8, Isaac dove into the crowd to save his friend from being pulled into the crowd by crowd surfers. And then...
There was a time that you were in jail for a week and a half. Can you talk about that?
I can. That's not that interesting. I got a DUI. I got crashed my van drinking and driving, you know? And so, you know, like, you just, like, that's... I deserve to go to jail for it. I got my friend dislocated her thumb, and I got attempted murder for that. And I didn't deserve attempted murder, but I can understand the sentiment. You know, like, I don't actually, there's no point when I was in jail that I actually felt like this isn't just. I could have killed someone, you know? I'm super lucky I didn't, you know? Like, and so if I have to deal with weird, freaky child molester dudes and, like, thugs for a week and a half to realize that, then fine, I had it coming. All right. you know, I'm not going to complain about it. It was weird. It sucked. I was, you know.
So things were getting pretty bad for the old Mouse boys. They got Brian Deck and Phil Eck involved again, but it wasn't much help. There was a lot of growing tension between drummer Jeremiah Green and Isaac, and it was getting much worse. At this point, they had all moved down to Portland to focus full-time on writing and recording their next album, but allegedly, these sessions just went horribly. Jeremiah and Isaac both had substance abuse issues at this point, and Jeremiah had a pretty violent breakdown. In his own words, "I wasn't communicating with people in an effective way. It just got really weird. I started having these religious hallucinations, I believed I could put curses on people, and I also started to think I was possessed by a demon." And after one particularly violent outburst, he left the band to seek help, being replaced by Benjamin Weichel of the Helio Sequence, who had toured with Ugly Casanova. But with one fire put out, another would soon spread. Producers Brian Deck and Phil Eck, despite their susically harmonious names, were not getting along as co-producers. The end result was that they both quit. So now, Modest Mouse had a rapidly approaching recording deadline with Epic, with no producer and a brand new drummer. Said Isaac, "I also had a friend die, and I suppose I hit the bottle harder than usual. Everyone's always saying I'm an alcoholic. At that point, I was." But never a quitter, Isaac also stated, "I didn't think I'd accomplished what I was meant to yet. Dan and Eric and I sat down and talked about everything. We were like, we're still into this. Let's do this. And then I wasn't worried anymore. Things had to reach a peak of bad news. Our goal was, fuck everyone. Fuck everyone who bailed on this project, everyone who made it hard. This album would get made by determination and vengeance."
Chametz or matzah?
Chametz or matzah?
Look, I'll try, but...
No trying.
Come home, now, okay? I have to go. Summer's having a Hebrew hernia.
Cohen!
CD went platinum. 2 Grammy nominations.
Modest Mouse.
Modest Mouse.
To say Float On was a game changer for this band is an understatement. These 3.5 minutes changed their professional lives. In August of 2004, the song peaked at number 1 on the US Rock Billboard chart and was basically heard all over the world. It was played on mainstream radio and in shopping malls. I remember my first time hearing it at the ripe age of 12 because my friend's mom had the CD. They had fully permeated our culture now that soccer moms were blasting that shit. And so, not only was this a watershed moment for Modest Mouse, it was kind of a watershed moment for indie rock in general. Trendsetting TV shows like The OC would feature indie bands like Death Cab for Cutie and Modest Mouse prominently in the show, propelling them to even greater heights of mainstream notoriety. As for its composition, Float On was actually written on a whim. Dan Gallucci had written the melancholy chord progression for the song's opening track, The World at Large, which in itself is arrestingly beautiful. One day while they were rehearsing, they decided to do a cover version of this song, increasing the tempo and giving it more of a swinging dance feel. And after jamming on this for a while, they had Float On. Now, the rest of the album, titled appropriately enough, Good News for People Who Love Bad News, is extremely distinct from the rest of their work up until that point. Modest Mouse was known for their long, meandering songs that developed over time and were structurally experimental. The themes of their lyrics tended to be raw and emotional, the problems of people in their 20s. On this album, however, Isaac made a concerted effort to be more concise, to have shorter songs, more deliberately crafted, that didn't roam or get tired, and he would begin exploring themes and motifs he never had before. Much less personal and much more absurd and theatrical. For me, Good News sounds like it comes from a nightmarish steamboat from 1880s New Orleans, full of swampy brass stabs and turn-of-the-century instrumentation. You have Isaac being a lot more goofy, plucking on a banjo, and doing a lot more, like, zany barking. You hear a lot more Tom Waits influence coming in.
Are you dead? Are you sleeping? Are you dead? Are you sleeping? Can I shout out? You are dead.
For me personally, this is where Modest Mouse starts to slip away a little. You have wonderful powerhouse songs like Float On, One Chance, Dance Hall, Black Cadillacs, but for me personally, there's a lot more silly tangents here. It's a lot more hit or miss than any of their previous work, which I feel has more consistency. The other single on Good News, The Ocean Breathes Salty, is a nice dreamy indie rock song with a prominent use of mellotron in the chorus, which I always appreciated. Well, this. You tell me what you want and I tell you what you get. You get away from me. You get away from me. Now, a few important things happened shortly after the success of Float On. Jeremiah Green came back, having sobered up and eager to jump back in. But because the band worked so well with Benjamin Weichel, Modest Mouse would have two drummers. They brought on Tom Peloso, a multi-instrumentalist, to flesh out the sound further.
Frost beating south of death against the lights, adding the breeze to the summer nights, outside water lock, spray.
Next would come the Johnny Marr era. As Dan Gallucci took his departure to focus on other projects, former Smiths guitarist Johnny Marr, to everyone's surprise, joined Modest Mouse on lead guitar. They began writing songs together in 2005, and would go into the studio the same year. Marr brought his own distinct writing style to the new album, which in early press interviews Isaac would describe as nautical-themed. Specifically, he described his new vision as a nautical balalaika carnival romp. The lead single off the album, Dashboard, is a disco-fused dance rock anthem featuring a distinctly Marr-esque guitar lick.
Well, it would've been, could've been worse than you would ever know. On the dashboard and melted, but we still have the radio.
Overall, a nautical balalaika carnival romp is a very accurate way of describing this album. Songs like Spittin' Venom, Steamin' Genius, Missed the Boat, it's all very on point. It was produced by Dennis Herring, the same producer on Good News, and has a similar high-fidelity, tight professional sound. It also featured Shins singer James Mercer on backing vocals on several of the songs, including my personal favorite, Florida. Television appearances, more touring with Johnny, but this album, titled We Were Dead Before the Ship Even Sank, didn't do quite as well as Good News, but it still was well received on alternative rock radio. It just really doubled down on the nautical theme, from the marketing to Isaac's fashion. In the meantime, they would release an EP of unused material from both Good News and We Were Dead, which for me is actually stronger than We Were Dead itself. An interesting side note, the band had befriended actor Heath Ledger shortly before his death, and he was in the middle of directing a music video for their song King Rat, which would have to be completed by others upon the actor's death. From this point onward, my timeline really speeds up, because the band really, really slowed down. Isaac even started a record label which, in a moment of self-awareness, he titled Glacial Pace, acknowledging that he was starting to work very slowly. They wouldn't re-enter the studio again for another 8 years, and it would be without Johnny Marr, and more crucially, without founding member Eric Judy.
8 years is a long time in...
That's what I'm told.
...in music.
I guess so.
Where'd you go?
I was in the woods a bit, looking at mushrooms and things, you know, like...
you were actually were working that whole time.
I was doing all sorts of stuff, yeah. I was producing other records, trying to run a record label, which is, I don't know why or how anyone, including myself, does it anymore.
You were just a real stickler about this album, is what
Yeah, there was that, too. Just getting too into the particulars. I quit sleeping. That was probably a bad call. And so I'd work on it for 6 days straight, just... finding anyone who is willing to work while other engineers slept or whatever, and then I'd have to sleep eventually, and I'd take my 4-hour nap and wake up and listen, and I'd be like, oh, this, we've got to redo all this, like this is the work of a crazy person, this sounds horrible. And so I'd work, in, you know, 3 days without sleeping. Again,
the fruit of these labors is the 15-track behemoth Strangers to Ourselves, released in 2015. This is a contentious one, and the long, overhyped build-up to its release didn't help. For many, it's a triumphant return to form for the band, an expression of both musical growth and an embracing of what made old Modest Mouse so uniquely magical. It's a misfire, a continuation of Modest Mouse's decline into formulas and redundancy. For me, while I do think it does have a lot of similarities to We Were Dead, I think it's a huge step up. I love this album a lot more. We wouldn't get new Modest Mouse material for another 6 years. Singles off their upcoming release, The Golden Casket, just dropped a few months ago. Ice Cream Party, Leave a Light On, and We Are Between, which I'm gonna refrain from judging too critically until I hear the entire album. We are. It may not be the Lonesome Crowded West. They're not 23 anymore. The boys are approaching 50, and they've given us a huge, unmatched body of influential work to enjoy. So I honestly feel like they can do whatever they want. They can retire, they can rest on their laurels, they can release a disco record, I don't care. The fact that these guys are still touring, still putting out new music, still carrying the torch of indie rock, as faint a torch as it is marvelous. Modest Mouse is basically an institution now. And I can't help but feel a strong sense of hometown pride, having grown up in the same town in Washington, and having witnessed their star-spangled career success.
That'll be the day that I die. That'll be the day when you make me cry. You say you're gonna leave me, you know it's a lie.
They were there before indie rock was even a thing, rode that wave to its absolute height, and now, in a post-rock world of trap music and hyper-pop artists, Modest Mouse is still over there being weird as f**k. Isaac continues to write his Mobius Band hip-hoppy melodies about paranoia, trailer parks, and outer space. Jeremiah Green is still laying down chatty, funky grooves, and hopefully, the evolution continues for many years to come. Maybe Eric Judy will come back, who knows? For now, I'm looking forward to hearing the rest of The Golden Casket and enjoying more of that sweet, haunting, unforgettable rock music.
Stop gas and working place, be table gas, be drive around.
stay there.